Good morning, Grant County. This is Pastor Terry Leap at the Williamstown Baptist Church, welcoming you to another live Sunday morning broadcast of our worship services here at the Williamstown Baptist Church. Each week, we like to remind you, our viewers, how blessed we are as a congregation to have you joining us through the medium of television. We hope that you're praying for us as we're meeting here and worshiping together this morning, because we want you to know that we are also praying for you who are watching us in the community. We have some very special things in store for you today on this Memorial Day weekend. We are going to end up our service somewhere near the end with a special tribute to the many members and family members of our church who have died over the last year. We're going to remember them and honor their memory. We're also going to be praying today in a very special way for a team from our church, 33 individuals, who will be leaving this Friday to go to Haiti to work with Haitian people, sharing the gospel of Christ and doing ministry on the field in Haiti. So you're going to hear us reference our Haiti missions team. And you'll notice about 33 of us today wearing these shirts, these blue shirts. These are all the team members who are going to be traveling to Haiti together. We covet the prayers of those of you who are at home watching us throughout this week, and as we're gone, please remember to pray for the missions team in Haiti. Now, we want you to remember that you can keep up with all of the events in the life of our church by going to our website, WilliamstownBaptistChurch.com. Again, WilliamstownBaptistChurch.com. And at the website, you can look at the calendar of events. You can also give to support our ministry through the website. You can give online, and it'll come directly to the general offering here at our church. But most importantly, you can pray for us. And if we can pray for you, please pick up the phone anytime this week, Tuesday through Friday, because our offices are closed tomorrow for Memorial Day. Tuesday through Friday, call us this week and share with us how we as a church can pray for you. If you'd like a visit from the pastor or from one of our deacons, if we can help meet some need in your life, please reach out to us. Let us know. We want to find out how we can be a blessing to you. This morning, as you watch our singing, our giving, our praying, preaching of God's word, we pray that you will be blessed and drawn nearer to Christ through all that happens here this morning. May God bless you as we worship. Good morning, church. Good morning, church. Welcome, everyone, to morning worship here at Williamstown Baptist Church. While you're filing in and finding your seats and our worship team's preparing to come out here in a few moments, I want to take these minutes before we begin to run through some quick announcements with you. So take out your bulletins for me. Most of you know by this point and have heard that we lost one of our own this week. Brother Sam Bailey passed this Thursday evening. He died, and his family is grieving his loss, and so we want the church family to know that we want you to pray for Kay and for Deb and Glenn, the whole family. Pray for the girls. Pray for all of them this week. And the announcements for Sam's funeral are as follows. The funeral will be right here at the church. Tuesday night visitation will be from 4 o'clock until 8 o'clock on site here at the church. And then Wednesday, the funeral will be here at the church at 1 o'clock, followed by a fellowship meal. So we want to honor Sam and thank his family for his many years of service to this church. Be there for them any way that you can. Keep them in your prayers. Also, you'll notice looking around you this morning that there are a lot of us wearing blue t-shirts. This is because all of us who are wearing t-shirts will be leaving this Friday for Haiti for a week, 33 of us. I think at least about 30 of us right here on site this morning. And at the end of our service today, we're going to close with a special prayer asking you, the congregation, to gather around us and pray for our safety and our blessing in all that we do. So just in case you were wondering why the preacher's wearing a t-shirt, you know, that's why. It's a special day, okay? Well, let it slide this once. Back to shirts and ties when I get back, okay? Inside the bulletin, please note the job opening on the left-hand side. Today's the last day to send in a resume or show some interest for the job opening in the preschool. Please let Cheryl Rich know that today if you're interested. Also, the church offices will be closed tomorrow and no evening service tonight because of Memorial Day weekend. We recognize the many celebrations, the many people who are traveling. Many who will go to special services or cemeteries this afternoon to remember well the memories of those who have passed, and particularly those who secure our freedoms. Please remember, kids, grades 3 through 5, that we are taking a group to Cedarmore Camp. Parents, we need to know, like today, if your kids are interested in going to camp. Talk to Daryl about that. You can also see my wife. Raise your hand, honey, so they know who you are. The pretty one here in the front row to the right wearing a brown dress. That's my beautiful... No, not Daryl. That's why I said the pretty one. Okay. Yeah. I'm just going to leave it at that, okay? The pretty one there in the front row. Please see Daryl or my wife, either one, about camp. We need to know. You don't have to pay today necessarily, but we need to know. Also, for anyone who's interested, men or women, the Crittenden Association will be hosting a trap shoot next Saturday. I think they're giving away some shotguns as door prizes. All funds will go towards Sunrise Children's Services. And this is out at Pleasant Ridge Baptist Church. Come see me if you'd like details about going. Okay, see me and I'll get you the details. I won't be here, so I won't be leading a group, but if you're interested in going, men or women, we'd love for you to go. Finally, the Super Seniors, you'll see their announcement there about the trip to the Kentucky Artisan Center. Debbie Taylor needs to know if you're interested. Where you at, Debbie? Oh, right behind me, okay. Debbie here behind me over my right shoulder. Please see her after the service today if you're interested or have questions about that trip. Finally, on the back, we want to make sure that no one goes unnoticed or uncelebrated. Miss Katie Dino, who's with us this morning. Wave, Katie. Yay, there in the back. We celebrated our graduates last week, and Katie was in Gatlinburg with her family, and so we want to acknowledge her graduation from Northern Kentucky University this year and celebrate that achievement in her life and say congratulations to you. She said, but I graduated in December, and I said, that's okay. We still want to celebrate it, so be sure to tell her on your way out today how proud you are of her and that accomplishment, okay? Now, turn in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews for our call to worship this morning. The book of Hebrews, and let's stand together to our feet in hearing the word of God. Hebrews chapter 4, beginning in verse 14. Let's pray that God's word would turn our hearts toward Christ. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. May God bless the reading and hearing of His word. Bow with me as we pray this morning. Father, we are grateful for the privilege of gathering here to worship You today. We pray that all we do would be to the glory of Christ, that His name would be lifted up, that men and women and boys and girls would be drawn nearer to Him, that we would not only be blessed, but that we would in turn be a blessing to others this morning as we gather as the corporate body of Christ to worship. Now, Lord, we have many needs. We've mentioned some of them today. We want to remember especially to pray for the family of Sam Bailey. Father, we want to pray for their comfort. We want to pray that Your Spirit would be very near to Kay and to the children and grandchildren today, to all of Sam's friends, to the community that he influenced and blessed. We pray that You would just send comfort in his passing, and that we as a church would respond appropriately with love, with service and ministry as we seek to reach out and be a blessing to the family. Now, Lord, we hold up before You today the many from this church who will be traveling this week on mission. And we pray for Your blessing to be upon them. Prepare our hearts even today as You are preparing the hearts of those in Haiti to whom we will go. Father, begin to open their hearts and their ears and their minds to hear and receive the gospel that we will share with them. And Lord, for our church family who will be praying for us, who will be holding us up before your throne, we pray that you would encourage them and strengthen them to pray and participate in this mission with us. Now, Lord, on this special weekend, we as Americans have been blessed to live in a free nation. And we recognize the ultimate sacrifice of those who went before us, who have secured this freedom and given their lives that we might enjoy the freedoms we have. And so we thank you for the privilege that not everyone in this world has. We thank you for the freedoms that we enjoy, and we pray that we would remember well and be blessed today by the memories of those who have gone before us, and especially those who have secured these freedoms. Above all, we have freedom in Christ, and for that we are thankful. And we pray these things in his name. Amen. Now, with a smile on your face, turn and find someone new and greet them this morning, welcoming them to our worship service. together, the greatest blessing of the freedom that we have is the freedom to proclaim eternal life in Jesus Christ. So let's stand together this morning and sing praises to Him. We're going to start with a song that some of you will recognize, a song of praise to our God.
Will be forever.
And it is because of that amazing freedom that we have found in and through Jesus Christ. Our chains are gone. We've been set free. We know freedom from the bondage of sin, from the curse of the devil himself, because of what Jesus Christ has done and is doing for us. And we are grateful for that. Turn with me this morning to John's Gospel, the second chapter. And while you are on your way there to John chapter 2, let me pause for one moment and just say a very, very happy anniversary today. A special anniversary that some of you may not have known about. Between a wonderful couple that came together a year ago. Right, Dennis? Me and this church. This is my 1 year anniversary. Yeah. So I've survived a year. Yeah. I officially started on June the 1st, officially, but I preached my first message as your pastor last year on May the 30th, which means I'm due for one Sunday's worth of pay, Dennis. I'm not forgetting that either. We'll work it out. But really, it has been a wonderful year for us, and we pray for the church as well. It has been a great year of transition. We have enjoyed every moment of it, and every day we are more and more thankful for God's call upon our lives to bring us here. For each one of you who, after a year, I think I can finally say I know just about everybody, although there's new faces popping up every week, new people that I'm getting to know, it has been a blessed year, and we have been thoroughly blessed by you, church. And so we are thankful for you and look forward to many, many, many more years, we hope, of celebrating anniversaries together as church and pastor. So in John chapter 2 this morning, not quite an anniversary, but I want to take you instead to a wedding ceremony. And we read beginning in verse 1. On the third day, this is the third day, back to chapter 1, the third day following John's initial pronouncement of Jesus' public ministry. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee. And the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now there were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it. And when the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called to the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone," and the implication here is everyone else, okay? "Everyone else," he says, "serves the good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, then the poor wine, but you have kept the good wine until now." Now pay close attention to verse 11. It's critical that you understand what John is saying here. This, the first of his signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested or showed his glory. And his disciples believed in him. Verse 11 again. This, the first of his signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested and showed, John is saying, we saw the glory of Christ in this unique way for the first time. That wedding in Cana of Galilee, and his disciples, John says, believed in him. Now, by way of introduction, let me say a few words about this miracle and about miracles in general in the Bible, in the gospel accounts. This is a real miracle. I believe that. It is a real supernatural act. Now, frequently we will use the term miracle. We kind of throw it around so much that it's lost all of its meaning. You know, When the Reds break a losing streak, we say, oh, it's a miracle. Well, no, it really wasn't a miracle. A miracle, properly defined, is something that happens outside of the ordinary processes and functions of nature. That's why we use the word supernatural synonymously with the miraculous. We're talking about something that is over and above natural processes. We wouldn't expect it to happen naturally. Even the birth of a baby. Yes, that beautiful new grandbaby, Jimmy. We all saw the pictures. We all saw a beautiful new grandbaby. But we say the birth of a baby sometimes is a miracle. Really, as beautiful as a baby might be, it's a very natural order of things that men and women procreate and conceive and babies are born. So that's not truly a miracle in the biblical sense. When we say Jesus performed a miracle, we're saying he did something that cannot naturally be understood in the realm of normal possibilities. We're saying he did something outside of the normal order of things. When he turned water into wine, this was not some trick. He didn't just wait till people turned their backs and pour in some wine into the water and say, "Ha, look!" This wasn't, as some liberal scholars say, a feat or a trick done by his disciples who just kind of snuck in wine in the back door and, you know, nobody saw it happen and they all assumed. No, this was a supernatural divine act whereby Jesus turned real water into real wine. And to deny either of those really is to cheapen the nature of this miracle. This passage was never written or intended to solve the modern day question of social drinking. Okay, that's not what this is about. It was really water, and he turned it into real wine. I've heard people try to use this to say, on one side of it, well, you see, preacher, Jesus turned water into wine, must have been okay. That's not what this passage is talking about. And if that's what you walk away with when you read John chapter 2, you've missed the whole point. This is not a prescription for enjoying a glass of wine at a party. Nor do we have to go to the extreme on the other side, as some people do, of denying, and I've heard this from conservative Bible-believing preachers, they go so far as to deny that this was wine. It couldn't have been wine. It was grape juice. Well, a simple reading of the context tells you that that's foolish. First of all, there are different words in the Greek, and John could have said grape juice if he wanted to, but he didn't. He said oinos, wine. This was real wine. Also, at festive celebrations like this, they drank real wine. And so there are two historical propositions when you read this that cannot be denied. First of all, that the Bible does indeed condemn drunkenness and a lack of self-control. You get that from the beginning of the Bible all the way to the end. Can't deny that. God is against drunkenness and lacking self-control in the consumption of alcoholic beverages. There's no question about that. But you also cannot deny, and it's indisputable, that in biblical times people drank wine. And you don't have to make sense of this passage. When you get to verse 11, this is why I said underline it, you discover that the real reason John is telling you about this miracle is because he wants you to see that Jesus, by doing the miraculous, manifests the glory of God, demonstrates the power of God, and shows himself to be that Messiah who has come into the world to bring salvation. So verse 11 ties the miracle of water to wine directly into chapter 20, verses 30 and 31. Do you remember? Remember John 20, 30 and 31? Jesus did do many other things, but these things I have written to you that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have eternal life. Everything that John writes in his gospel flows out of that intent. He wants you to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, that he is the incarnation of the eternal God, that he is the promised one, that he is God wrapped in the flesh who comes to this world, dies for our sins, rises from the dead. And while he is here walking amongst us, he demonstrates to the world that power, that presence, that anointing. Remember chapter 1 when John the Baptist said, "I saw the Spirit descend on him and it remained." Jesus demonstrates that powerful anointing of the Spirit in John's gospel through a series of miracles. We're going to see 7 miracles in John's gospel. The number of completion. He wants us to see 7 times over that Jesus could and did, as the promised Messiah, the Son of God, work outside of anything we can naturally explain. And so in verse 11, the emphasis is upon the belief of the disciples when they saw and witnessed this miraculous deed. Now stop and think about this for a moment. Because we might tend to assume that when a miracle is performed in Scripture, the real reason for that miracle is for the happiness of the recipient of the miracle, right? I mean, let's be honest. This is how some of you guys pray. Lord, miraculously send me the lottery numbers so that I can win $1 million, you know. Or Lord, miraculously send me that new red Corvette. You want a miracle that benefits you. And when we read about Jesus healing the sick or raising the dead or casting out demons or calming the seas, we might tend to think that the reason he did miraculous stuff was for the benefit of the recipients. But that's really not why Jesus does the miraculous. That's not the primary reason. Now, the happiness of the recipient may be a fringe benefit, but the real reason that Jesus the Messiah performs miracles in the midst of all these people who are watching and see this is so that they would know that dwelling in their midst was the very incarnation of God. So that they would know that the powerful Creator, the one who spoke heaven and earth into existence, and who is not by any stretch of the imagination contained by the realms of nature, they would know that Jesus was the I Am in their midst, who could raise his hands and calm a storm, who could say the word and water is turned into wine, who could take loaves and fishes and without any natural explanation multiply them to the feeding of thousands. The natural benefit is nice, but that's not the real primary reason behind miracles. The primary reason for miracles in the Bible is always to authenticate the ministry of the miracle worker. See, some of you might tend to think that if God would just do some miracle in your presence today, in your midst, that if you could witness with your own eyes a real miracle, that you would never again waver in your faith. Have you ever felt that way? Well, God, if you would just heal my mom or my dad, or if you would just heal my child, or if you would just get me out of this bind and do something miraculous, then surely I will never waver. I'll come to church every Sunday. I'll be there every week. I'll tithe. I'll sing in the choir. I'll do whatever you want. We fool ourselves into believing that, but it's not true. In fact, the testimony of Scripture over and over again, what we see during the life of Jesus, was that there were multitudes of people who witnessed the miraculous with their own eyes. Many of them saw multiple miracles performed by Jesus and still did not believe. Never make the mistake of thinking that the reason for your unbelief is because God hasn't done enough or that God hasn't sent you a sign or a miracle. The reason for your unbelief is your love of sin, your stubbornness, your hardness of heart. And just like the exchange between Lazarus and the rich man, do you remember that exchange? Lazarus and the rich man, Lazarus said, "Oh, if you could just send me back to tell my brothers." I'm sorry, the rich man says, "If you could just send me back to tell my brothers about this place, then surely they'd get on the straight and narrow then." Do you remember the response? No, they wouldn't. They have Moses and the prophets, and they ignore them. What makes you think they would believe merely because they saw something outside the ordinary? See, we live in a day and time when there has been a resurgence in the last two decades or so of interest in evangelical circles in sort of signs and wonders. And there are those who are out there seeking for signs, looking for the miraculous as a basis or foundation for their faith. Nowhere will you find that prescribed in the Bible. In fact, what you will find is Jesus himself in Matthew chapter 12, verses 38 through 45, saying to those who seek signs as a basis for their faith, he says, "A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after signs, and no sign will be given to you." He goes on to say, "The sign of Jonah will be the greatest sign of all." And he gives a reference to the fact that he, the Son of Man, is going to die on a cross and be buried in a tomb and rise from the dead and be seen by many. That's going to be the greatest sign for all ages. You don't need another miracle. A great miracle has already been performed for you. The raising of Jesus Christ from the dead. He died for your sins. He was buried in a tomb. And by the power of God, he rose from the dead. It's an understatement to say that that's not natural or normal. Have you ever seen anyone else rise from the dead? The resurrection of Jesus happened outside of any natural explanation. Hebrews chapter 1 reminds us that in times past, God has spoken to our fathers through the prophets and through various and sundry ways, but in these last days, he hath spoken through his Son. You don't need a new sign. You don't need to wait on some new miracle. In fact, the signs and wonders movement that is being perpetuated in evangelical circles today is in many cases very unhealthy. It is unbiblical and in some cases even heretical. They emphasize the seeking of signs or miraculous deeds as a basis for believing. They say that God will show up and sprinkle gold dust on preachers, or give you great amounts of money, or grow gold teeth into your head if you just believe enough. And then because of that sign, you'll believe. If you think I'm exaggerating, by the way, trust me, I'm not. These things are really being told and taught out there in the world. This is why you should believe. This is why you should believe, they say, because God will do miraculous things. He'll provide manna inside of your Bible. You'll open it up and there will be real manna there if you just believe. And that's a sign, and that's what you need. By the way, their manna looks conspicuously like Ritz crackers. But there are people saying that this is what you need if you're going to believe. It's not, friend. The greatest miracle has already taken place. It's important to acknowledge that God does from time to time reveal himself in ways that only he chooses to do. He may do some miracle in your life. He may do some miraculous deed that I cannot explain. But it is most important to note that that is not what we are called to seek after. We are called to believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. To believe that the greatest miracle has already transpired in the resurrection of the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't be drawn into this strange signs and wonders movement. Well, I got to come back to the text, because I could talk about that all day. Some of the guys that I disciple know this is a very interesting discussion, isn't it, guys? And where this is going in evangelical Christianity is very strange. Don't be drawn into it. The greatest miracle is already here. Let's come back to the text, though, in John chapter 2 and talk about Jesus at this wedding. In chapter 2, John's giving us two snapshots of Jesus in everyday life, as it were. We find him in the first half of chapter 2 at a wedding, and in the second half of chapter 2, we find him at church. Actually, worshiping, you see, in verse 13 at the temple in Jerusalem. But for the sake of discussion, we'll say in the first half he's at a wedding, in the second half he's at church. And while at this wedding, a problem arises. And Jesus, by his very presence and by his power, provides the solution. And so jot this down. If you like outlines, you'll see it pop up here in a few moments behind the things I'm saying. But verses 1 and 2 show us Jesus participating in the ordinary events of life. So there's participation factor. Jesus is interested in and involved in ordinary day-to-day events during his earthly ministry. And I don't want to undersell the importance of that. Because sometimes we tend to believe that Jesus isn't interested in what's going on in my workplace, and he's not interested in what's going on in my home, and Jesus doesn't really care about how I'm struggling in a friendship or how I act on the baseball field. You know, Jesus, he's not interested in that stuff, because we all know that Jesus is just church, right? Jesus is a church guy. This is where we meet with Jesus, is at church. He's not interested in the daily events of life. And many Christians today have a very compartmentalized Christian faith. You're a Christian on Sunday. And when you come to church, you worship and you sing and you celebrate and you give and we raise our hands and we celebrate. But then we don't take Christ with us into the ordinary events of our daily lives. So the presence of Jesus doesn't impact how we act at work or how we act at the gym or how we act in the ball field. No, because we say to ourselves, my religion is what I do on Sunday. That's not Christianity. In verses 1 and 2, we find Jesus, and throughout the Gospel of John, we're going to find Jesus participating in, during his lifetime, ordinary events. He is invited to this wedding. Huge social events in the first century. Celebrated sometimes for upwards of a week. People would get together, hundreds of people, extended families, people from other towns and communities. They would all get together to celebrate this wedding. There would be feasting, there would be singing, there would be dancing, there would be wine provided for the guests. This was a rich celebration. And Jesus' mother was invited, and Jesus also, verse 2, was invited. Good idea, by the way. We don't know who this couple is, but it's great that they invited Jesus into their marriage from the beginning. Good advice there. And Jesus shows up with his disciples graciously. He gives consideration to the invitation. You always find Jesus in the Gospels in the presence of ordinary people. He's not a Savior who is isolated from ordinary people or isolated from the events of the world or sort of tucked away in his office, in his study, aloof of what's going on in ordinary people's lives. This is why I read at the beginning of the service from Hebrews chapter 4, where we're reminded that our great high priest has endured many of those same trials and temptations and struggles that you and I will go through in the course of an ordinary day. The ordinary events of life that you've either pushed Jesus out of or you think and reason to yourself that he doesn't care about those things. Verses 1 and 2 remind us that Jesus was not immune to being where ordinary people were at, to facing problems that ordinary people faced. And this is where we begin to see his power demonstrated. Because in verse 3, his mother comes to him and says, look at the beginning of verse 3, we're out of wine, Jesus. We're out of wine. A great problem, by the way, for the groom. This would have been a social embarrassment, social humiliation. Put it in this context. Imagine you got married, and you had a feast, a celebration, and everyone showed up and there was no chicken. There was no potato salad. And they forgot the wedding cake. Can you imagine your wedding reception without fried chicken, potato salad, and cake? You'd be horribly embarrassed. You'd have 100 or 200 or 300 people sitting there with plastic forks in their hands waiting for something to eat and no food. And they would all look to you and say, what happened? Man, you really dropped the ball. That's what Jesus was facing here at this wedding. The groom faced certain dishonor and humiliation and embarrassment because the wine was out. And Jesus' mother comes to him saying, Jesus, we've got a problem. We've got a problem here. Someone's facing sure humiliation and embarrassment at this wedding. And problem presents itself. Problems do that. They present themselves daily in our lives. They're often unexpected, usually unpredictable. Some of them are titanic problems that we don't know how to overcome. Some of them are small, ordinary, day-to-day, mundane problems. Flat tires, or busted belt. Button flies off my shirt. I'm late for work. My car's broken. Something's messed up with my bank account. Problems present themselves in our lives each and every day. And when you study the life and the ministry of Jesus, you find that everywhere he goes, there are people facing problems. And not all of them are huge. Not all of them are going to require a supernatural miracle to mend. But wherever he goes, he faces problems. And one thing that I've learned about problems is all of us deal with them. I've learned that they consume way too much of our time, energy, and emotional capital. And I've seen from experience working with Christians that we seldom turn to God for His wise counsel and guidance and direction in dealing with the ordinary mundane problems of our lives. In fact, turning to God's usually the last thing we do. We'll try to figure it out ourselves first. We'll try to solve it ourselves. We'll try to step outside the will of God if that's what's necessary to make sure that we can fix this problem. But the last thing that we do is turn to the God who is intimately involved in the ordinary events of our lives, who wants to be there present with us, operating with us by the power of His Spirit, helping us through ordinary problems. Don't make turning to God the last thing you do when you face problems. Make it the first thing you do. And by His powerful presence, what Jesus Christ, through His Spirit, will always do is He will guide you back to His Word for guidance and direction. He will guide you back to the people of God for wise counsel and provision. He will drive you towards a deeper reliance upon the Spirit's power to trust the Father's plans in every problem that you face. That's just good counsel, no matter what you're facing. Turn to God's Word first. Trust in His Spirit. Turn to the body of Christ, the church. Listen to the counsel and wisdom of others. Trust the provision of God through His people. Stop trying to solve everything yourself without realizing that the ever-present and all-powerful Christ wants to work with you through the trials of your life. And so when the problem is presented, Jesus provides a solution. It's a strange solution. In these verses, notice that his mother, her good advice is, she tells the servants, you just do what Jesus says. That's good advice coming from his mother. Follow his commands. Run to Jesus, she says, and do whatever he says. That's the counsel, by the way, of the very mother of Jesus. The only place in Scripture where Mary gives any kind of command, and it is, go to Jesus and do what he says. Well, in verses 6 through 9, here's the solution, he says. Go to those water jars, those big stone pots that are full of wash water. That's what it was. It was water that was used for the purification rituals. You dip your hands down in it, you wash them off, you throw some up on your face. This was symbolic washing. And some commentators believe, and I think they're right on here, that these pots are symbols of the emptiness of the ritualism of Judaism in Jesus' day. They're a symbol of how empty the rituals were. The religious crowd going through the motions, washing their hands, showing up at church, giving, singing, tithing, without the presence of Christ. Jesus says, go to those empty pots and fill them up to the top. And when the servants do this, they find that the water has been changed. Supernaturally, it has been turned. Jesus' methods were unconventional. They often will be when you turn to Him. The miracle was unexpected. Notice the surprise in the words of the Master in verse 9 when he tastes the wine and sees that it's changed. But the results are undeniable and unbelievable. The Master of the feast says in verse 10, hey, something unique is happening here. Usually people give you the best wine on the front end of the celebration. The expensive stuff, the good stuff. And then after a few days of feasting and celebrating when you're tired and worn down, that's when they save money by serving the cheap stuff. But that's not what the master of this ceremony has done. The master says, no, no, this bridegroom has done just the opposite. No, you've had the weak stuff. Now you're getting the new wine, the good wine. The best stuff is coming here at the end. Some say that this is a reference to the first covenant, the law which came through Moses, being inadequate or insufficient to bring real joy and real transformation. And that it's only with the coming of Jesus Christ in the new covenant that one finds real fulfillment and joy and life. I think it's an adequate picture here. A wonderful picture that through the working of Christ in this unbelievable manner, He meets not only a physical need. We often talk about meeting physical needs. You know, we gotta meet people's needs, we say. And there's some truth to that. Jesus definitely meets a physical need here. But the greater need that's met in verse 11 is spiritual. Because in the presence of this powerful Christ, He provides, and through this provision and through this miraculous deed, verse 11, His disciples are turned to believing deeply in Him. They had already decided at the end of chapter 1 to believe in Him. Many of them have already said, hey, we believe He's the Messiah, He's the guy. Now, the foundations are shored, solidified. They know after the first miraculous deed that there is something unique and powerful about this Jesus Christ. It's more than just physical needs. It is spiritual blessings and is a little bit of foreshadowing of even greater things to come. Let me ask you this morning to read this miracle of Christ, perhaps an old story that you've heard many, many times before, in a new light. It's not just about the wine, the wedding, the celebration. This is about you being confronted with the reality that Jesus is the all-powerful one. That Jesus performs miracles because of who He is. That His own disciples were not so much wowed by the water to wine, but they knew now that this Jesus, who was interested in ordinary day-to-day events, could transform people by His power and by His provision because He was the Messiah. Have you believed this morning that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that through Him you have eternal life? Is Jesus an active and present participant in the events of your daily life? I want you to ponder that today. Is He an active and present participant in the daily events of your life, or have you pushed Jesus to Sunday morning only? If He's not Lord of all of your life, He's not Lord at all in your life. Are you seeing His power at work in the problems that you face every day? Are you even turning to Him for solutions? Are you experiencing the blessing of provision that comes to those who turn to the all-powerful Christ for their every need? Yes, this is indeed the Son of God. This is the Messiah. This is the Savior who is mighty to save. Like the disciples, I ask you this morning, have you believed in Him? Are you following Him? Would you trust Him even today? Have you believed in this Jesus? Are you following Him? Would you trust Him, turning from your sins even today? Father, through this miracle, I pray that You would speak to our hearts about who Jesus Christ is and how He is so worthy of and deserving of our worship and our admiration and our very lives. And Father, if there is one here today who has not believed, who has not turned from their sins and said, Christ is Lord of my life, then by Your Spirit, Lord, speak to their hearts and draw them today. Give them the courage to step out and say, I want to know, how can I be saved? And we will show them from the Word of God. Father, others who are here may recognize that when they leave this church, they do not take Jesus with them into their daily lives. They think You're not concerned about ordinary things. And Lord, I pray that You would convince them today that You are, and that You are powerful and able to provide for our every need if we will turn to You in the midst of our trials. Speak to us, draw us now, grow Your church, and glorify Your Son. During this time of invitation, we pray. Amen. Stand with me this morning as we sing together, Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God. And if you're not doing that, make today the day of your seeking.
First the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia.
Chad and Lauren and Brooklyn and Elijah. I'm going to tell them this, Chad, because I think it was funny. Chad said to me last week, he said, well, I think when I walk the aisle, I'm going to walk waving a white flag, because he said it's been a long time coming. We have been praying for many months that God would lead them, and they come this morning saying, we feel that God is leading us to unite with this church from the Dry Ridge Baptist Church. And Chad and Laura, of course, they've just brought their children to be with them. The membership transfers for Chad and Laura, and I'll ask you both, do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? You're trusting in Him and Him alone for eternal life.
Yes.
All right, good answer, Elijah. And the two of you have both followed Him in obedience to biblical baptism by immersion. You're coming to us from a sister church of like faith and order, right?
Yes.
All right, church, all those who are excited about their decision to unite with us, let them know that with a hearty amen.
Amen.
All right. Amen. Elijah's happy too. Now we're going to ask you guys to go ahead and be seated here in the front, because as our ushers come this morning, everyone go ahead and be seated. We only do this once a year, okay? And it really is a very special time for us as a church on Memorial Day. We're going to sort of wrap up our services this morning with a special video that's going to play as we receive our offering today. These are our loved ones, friends and family members, who over the course of the last year have left this world. And we pray this morning that through this video, you all would be blessed by their memory. As you remember them well. Brother Rick Skinner, could you pray for our offering this morning?
Dear Lord, we come to you again. Thank you for this day, for the opportunity you give us, Lord, to come out and worship in your house. We just ask, Lord, a special prayer right now on the slides that will be shown and the ones that we've lost this year, that you'll comfort and be with the families in their loss. just ask, Lord, that you be with this church, your honor, and make it true. We also ask, Lord, to take these tithes and offerings and use them for the upbuilding of thy kingdom. We sing to ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Completed this for this year, and when we found about Brother Sam's passing this week, he'll be on next year's, but I hope that his family remains close to your heart as you pray for Kay and the children over these next few days. So we decided to put that at the end of the service because we knew it just tore a lot of us up emotionally to think back and remember God's faithfulness over this last year, being with us as we've lost people that we love dearly. And so we did it at the beginning of the early service, and then it was just terrible. We couldn't get everybody back at the beginning, so we put it at the end, and we pray that their memories will be a blessing to each and every one of you. I'm going to ask the last thing as we dismiss this morning. The final closing thing we want to do is to ask all of our blue shirts, all of our Haiti team, to gather up here together in the front. And we're going to invite you, the congregation, to stand to your feet, first of all. And those from the balcony, if you want to come on down and join us, we're just going to ask everyone to kind of slide out towards the middle. And some of our deacons gather up here in the front. They're going to place hands upon us That's right, we're doing it in a Baptist church. Go on, don't be shy, gather on around us. We're going to put hands on one another and pray this morning. We have stressed throughout this whole process that this is not just a trip for us 33 who are going. It is a trip for our whole church community. And I cannot stress enough how much we are relying upon the undergirding of your prayers to be with us as we travel this next week. So go on and file out. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Come on up here and take the hands of someone close to you. Place your hands on those around you. And this is how we do it. We take one hand and we place it on someone on their shoulder. There we go. That's right. Appropriate touch here. And it's okay. And we're all going to be praying over one another and for one another. And I'm asking one of our travelers, as well as one of our deacons, Brother Doug Stanley, to pray over our team. And with this prayer, we'll dismiss this morning. So, Doug?
Would you pray with me, please? Lord, we thank you for this group of young people and adults and their willingness to serve you and to take the command as you have given it to go to the ends of the earth, Lord. And I just pray that you'll give each of us open hearts and open minds as we travel to Haiti and to just do the missions that you've called us to do. Lord, I also pray for the people of Haiti that we will encounter and even those that we don't encounter but may receive the blessings that we take over there. I pray that you'll bless them with open hearts and open minds as well to receive the message that we bring. Lord, I pray for safe travels and health as we're there. I pray for our church family here, that they will continue to keep us in their prayers as we're gone, and that they will remember us and just, like Pastor said, undergird us the entire time that we're away. It's in your name that I pray. Amen.
God bless you. Enjoy your weekend. Be safe. We'll see you back Wednesday night for prayer meeting.